Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the city of Coatesville. I'm Linda Lavender Norris. I'm the city council president, and it's with great pleasure to have you all here. Just quickly to address the elephant in the room. I want to let everybody know that this is not by any means a political event. We will not play politics with our youth, with their safety, their education, or no one else in our community for that matter. I have the pleasure of having a relationship with our state representative, known him for years, and I'm sure many of you have too. He has a concern about our issues. Therefore, he has scheduled and arranged this meeting tonight. I'm extremely grateful to you, Mr. Lewis, for doing so, and to all of you for attending. I stand here as the council president. My loyalty is to the residents of the city of Coatesville. Make no mistake about it. I'm not concerned about your party affiliation because problems are across the table. Republican, Democrat, Independent, what have you. An issue is an issue that everybody has to deal with. With that being said, we have arranged that this meeting go forth from 3 weeks ago, and tonight there will be a meeting here that is starting now as I speak. There'll be no other meeting going on. I don't want to disappoint, but I also want to clear the air. This is the city of Coatesville. I have the utmost respect for all the residents and everybody in the room, but I will not stand for anybody, any resident being exploited for political reasons. I will not, I promise you. That's not my place, and I won't try to fit in it. That being said, it's with great pleasure I introduce and present at the same time State Representative Harry Lewis. Would you please welcome him as he comes? Thank you.
Thank you, Madam President. Thank you all for coming. I felt real good sitting over there looking out at you in this comfortable chair and everything. But I want to say once again, good evening to all of you. And I think Mrs. Lavender made it crystal clear why we are here. We're here because we're concerned, in particular, about the safety in our schools. Very, very concerned. And I understand about that concern simply because of the news media, what's happening in other cities, what's happening with students, what's happening regarding our children in these various schools, even down to the middle schools and elementary schools. I'm from here. I've worked here my entire life. I graduated from Coatesville High School, Scott High School at the time. And let me tell you, ladies and gentlemen, I've dedicated my life to this city. I worked as an educator for 41 years in the same school district. I've had interactions, even with some of your grandparents in here. And I took on this job. I didn't ask for it. The opportunity was presented to me. I just didn't think about it overnight. It took me a year or so. But then I said, why not? Why not? Don't rest on your laurels. My investment in this community is my life. This has given me an opportunity, this position, to come back to you. And I don't have to rededicate anything, because I've continually worked every single day for this city and now this area. A lot of you in here had me as a coach. You had me as a teacher. In some instances, as a principal. I'm going to ask you to raise your hand. That'll really date me. But if you want to raise your hands, if you had association with me in education, just raise your hand. Let's see what we have. So it's like addressing a gym class. But first, despite the challenges we face, and the reason I mention that, we can create solutions together. Thus the purpose of this meeting. That's the reason. Those are the reasons I've called all of us here together. First, I want to briefly explain what I've been doing over the past few months. I've met on several occasions already with the superintendent, some of the school administrators. I brought in the district attorney with the superintendent and local law enforcement. Together, we've recommended new security measures for the high school campus. Additionally, listen to this, because the rumors out there run rampant. It amazes me why we think like we do when we don't have the facts. I have secured over $500,000 increase in state funding for the Coatesville Area School District. You check that out. In this short period, we caught heck up in Harrisburg, but that's what we got for Coatesville. And I have the documentation if you want to see it. I am engaged in our schools, and I will continue to be engaged on this issue, this safety issue for our students, until we see positive results. And once again, and you're going to hear me say this and repeat this, we have to work together. When I was here and back in school district, Coatesville is a powerful place. We just lost our way somewhere. We've become disconnected. We have to reconnect. And all of you stakeholders in this room can help me and help ourselves and help our community resolve that. I mean that sincerely. We have to get rid of the attitudes and our own self-interest and our own purposes. We can't make the decisions that affect this entire area ourselves, or as one group, or as one person. We have to come to the table, ladies and gentlemen. We can't assume anything. After the news reports last week, a couple weeks ago, hearing from so many of you, I have called this community forum, and that's exactly what it's going to be, because I share your concerns once again. As your state representative, my number one job is to hear from you and be your voice. I remember a couple years ago, we didn't have a voice, or we thought we did, but we found out we didn't. And tonight, I hope to hear from as many of you as possible so I can take your concerns with me today back to the school board, the district administration, and the Harrisburg. I just want to acknowledge that we do have district personnel here, school boards. It touches my heart that we are all here. It really, really does, because this has to be the start. Newspapers, TV, if you're here tonight, headlines tomorrow. Coatesville comes together as a united community to help solve our problems. We have to do that, ladies and gentlemen. And we can start right here in this room. All the stakeholders. We have school personnel. We have families. We have families that have felt threatened through these insecurities in the schools. We want to address all of that. Once again, I'm gonna put this out there. I challenge the reporters to report the facts and make tomorrow's headlines once again. Coatesville community united for safe schools. This will not be a one-time meeting. This will not be a one-time meeting. We will have an immediate follow-up. Once school is settled and once things settle down, we want to meet with all of the stakeholders and those people that are involved with this. And the number one thing we need to address are our safety issues. We got police chiefs, we got security, we got everybody here from all over the area that are connected to our schools. We want to work with them. We want to work with them. We are here to share some of our stories about school safety in the Coatesville School District. In consideration of everyone's time, we will only hear from those who wish to speak on that topic. If someone has already expressed their concern, I ask that you allow others to speak. My staff will have some microphones, so please raise your hand if you wish to speak, and they will come to you. I ask that everyone be respectful this evening. We stay on topic and be considerate of those with different opinions. Remember, we are here because we are concerned about the safety of our schools and because we care about Coatesville. My pledge to you is that I will listen carefully and my staff will take notes so I can share them with the school district officials. Even though some of them are here tonight, they know because they are concerned just as we are. I've been an administrator for a long time, ladies and gentlemen. There have always been fights in schools. Never to this magnitude for whatever reason, but we have to address them and work with them. But it's not only a school problem. We have to communicate with the parents. We're talking about your kids that are involved in these fights. The teachers don't start the fights. We have to talk about disrespect. We have to talk about the disrespect in the classroom. We have to talk about those kids that dropped the four-letter word that's not proper in any setting. We have to help our kids help themselves. And once again, the community, ladies and gentlemen, we are all a part of this problem. We are all creative enough to work on the solutions. We have to be in our schools. The parents have to be in their schools. They have to connect with their kids. I can tell you stories that you've never heard about with fights in schools with our kids. And now there's a new dimension, technology, cell phones, pictures. We see it all over the national news. In Harrisburg, they're talking about this. We want to come up with a law or a bill to address that. We can address a lot of things, but the bottom line when we talk about our children are the parents. You have to work with your students. We have the resources. The school district have the resources. But the other thing, we have to respect and believe in and help our teachers. How many of you have ever been in a classroom with 25 to 30 to 35 students and try to teach a lesson? And then there's one disruption or two disruptions. Or if a fight breaks out, that destroys the entire school for the day because it's all gossip the rest of the day and the students have lost that yearn that day to learn. I'm very, very, very serious about this. And I'm not ashamed to contact you, talk to you, call me. I am one person, but I will take the leadership if I have to, along with our district administrators. They need help. Our students are our number one priorities. We're graduating a high school class tomorrow. I'm so proud of those young people because they got through this. And nobody in this room has been through more high school graduations than I have. I guarantee you. And those students are proud. They're celebrating. Let's continue to make them proud that they are from Coatesville. Our teams, when they represent us and represent our city, and they go out and they hear negative comments from other people because of the news media or because what we say as a city, your city doesn't care about you. That's come to me. I've heard that. That's ridiculous. I was a coach. We got nothing but respect because our kids knew how to handle themselves. They still do. We have to give them that support. We don't want to continue to suspend everybody. That's where the parents come in once again. If there's a problem, call the parent in and make them accountable. We have to be accountable as parents. Disciplinary-wise, when our students are threatened, when I go to these schools, I see no tolerance for bullying. Where do you think these fights come from? A lot of our kids don't even live next door to each other. They all catch buses and go throughout the area. They don't even play together after school. But when they come to school through technology and media and what someone said, that's what creates a lot of this nonsense. We have to be on top of it. We have to work with our kids. I don't like to come up and I don't like to lecture and tell you about this and tell you about that without having a solution. We have to be able to problem solve. We have to face these situations head on. We have to give our teachers and our administrators the confidence to deal with this without the fear of any flashback or any repercussions. That affects the classroom effectiveness of the teacher. We have a lot of teachers that aren't from this area. They can't speak as a lot. They're here to learn. They're here to help our children. They're here to educate them. We have to support them. And there's a way to deal with fights. I guess, never mind. I'm flashing back to when I was a principal or administrator or an assistant principal. But we have to go back to this neighborhood thing where you go to the school, drop by. Back to school nights. That was one of my big things in school. We had back to school night, meet your teacher night. I'd go up to the elementary school and we'd ride around. You couldn't find a parking space. And as you went to the middle schools, But when you got to the high school, it was pathetic. The parents had showed up. We took counts, and on some occasions, but over 2,300 students on that campus, we may have or might have had 500 parents show up in a two-day period. Connection. Be a part of the school. Don't be a problem for the school. We have new people in our community. Some of them haven't been here long enough to know the community. They think they know. Some of them see what's happening with our kids. Volunteer. We have tons of organizations. And the high percentage of our students, ladies and gentlemen, are class acts. Let me tell you. We have scholarships exclusive to the Coatesville High School. How many of you know of the Newland Foundation, a Newland Scholarship. If you know it, raise your hand. We've been in existence 5 years. We graduated our first class this year. Right now, and we deal with the students that may fall through the cracks or whatever, we offer them an opportunity. Right now, this moment as I speak, we have 14 young people in the college of their choice. We guarantee if they maintain their GPA, they will graduate with a degree without any financial problems. That's here in Coatesville. We just recruited, or we're in the process of recruiting. Where's my wife? I hate to have to call on her all the time, but she is chairman of that. And they're in the process of interviewing another 5 students, which will make 19 Coatesville students. Guaranteed degree. You do your part. You study. It's there. The Harry Lewis Jr. Scholarship. I was blessed with that, with my connection with the Brandywine Health Foundation. $20,000. You remember the Lucan Scholarship a long time ago? That was the big scholarship. The Harry Lewis Jr. Scholarship matches that, $5,000 a year for 4 years. How many of you heard the Coatesville Youth Initiative? I am one of the originators. 2 of us started that, and we interviewed Ms. Kaya Scott. I saw her here earlier. Look how it's thriving. That's working together. The Bridge Program. All of these programs we have connected specifically to Coatesville High School. And we're here talking about safety for our kids, or what we can't control. We need support from everybody, ladies and gentlemen. Everybody. Volunteer. Don't sit back and rest on your laurels. Don't feed a lot of misinformation. Go right to the source. Come to me. We have so much influence in this area. We're getting ready with Coatesville to start this major revitalization. I know we've talked about a lot of things, but they're actually coming in to play. I didn't realize how much paperwork and how many years it takes to get one thing done, crossing the T's, dotting the I's. I happened to be at the G.O. left Harrisburg, came down to the G.O. Carlson Airport yesterday for ribbon cutting. They opened up the south apron at the south end of the runway because of the helicopter, Sikorsky, and planes landing and jets. You know, there was a close call not too long ago. We're trying to get a tower up there. But just to open that apron yesterday, it is amazing. They started that project in 2005. And I have the fact sheet. And they never missed a beat. It was just completed yesterday. So it takes a lot of persistence, it takes a lot of consistency, it takes a lot of continuity, it takes a lot of working together. I want to have another meeting. After we have this meeting, I'm going to let you talk in a few minutes or express why you're here about this safety concern. But everybody's here involved, and we have enough people that will hear you. We're not attacking anyone. We want to come to a solution. And I have the authority to take it to the right people. I have the authority to talk and make something happen with collaboration, with agreements, with all of the stakeholders. Ladies and gentlemen, we got to do this. We must do this. Don't think about yourself sometimes. Help those kids in the street. Don't be afraid. Get our young people involved in athletics. You ever been outside of Coatesville and see the playground activity with the parents out there with their kids in other communities? It's amazing. We have to work with the city, advance a lot of our parks, and come up with playground equipment for our cities. That takes the school district and the city working together. Those are the kinds of things that we have to do. Oh boy, being this politician thing, I'm learning a lot from being in Harrisburg. I can't shut up sometimes. And I thought I was bad, and there are a lot of guys worse off than me, because if you have that feel and it's in here, that's what you gotta do. You have to be compassionate, not just a politician. Not because I'm Harry Lewis, the state representative. I'm Harry Lewis, still call me Harry. But I'm here. I'm here for you. And nobody in here can question that. You talk to me, I'll do anything that I can to help you within my power. I will. And here I go again. My wife works as hard as I do for this community, because we are sincere and we care about all of you. We care about everybody. I can keep going. I don't want to be repetitive. Let's start this conversation. I have staff members that are in the back, and they will come to you. Raise your hands, and they will come to you. Miss Amber Little, one of my staffers, and you'll start, and I'm going to pull a chair up.
If you could just state your name.
My name is Elwood Dixon. I worked for the school district for over 30 years. I worked for over the school district for 30 years. So I know that school system in and out. And talking about solutions, and that's what I want to talk about, is solutions. Because I remember when two teachers, Carl Smith and another teacher and I, went out to get parents to come to the school, because they wanted to talk to those kids about taking tests. We went to, I believe, in the time that we spent out there, we went to 60 homes. And out of 60 homes, we had 15 families to come. That's pitiful. That shows no interest. Now, the other thing that I want to say is about when there are fights. Those fights have to be stopped immediately. And some punishment has to be put out. Because if you don't, you will have it continuously. That stops other kids from learning. That's what they're there for. So I'm saying that if we get people, and it takes parents to be there in the classrooms. Come peep in the window. That's all. See how your kid is reacting. If you don't like what the teacher is doing, go to the principal. Don't go home. Don't pull your shade down. Don't tell somebody else, because somebody else don't care. The only person that has to care is you. So what you have to do is to be ready when them fight starts. We used to take kids, the custodians, because I was a custodian at one time. We used to take, when we see the kids in the hallway, we would either march them to the office or take them back to their classroom. Today, if you try to do that, the kids will cuss you out. But you have to do it anyway, because it has to stop immediately. I used to go with Harry, back and forth with Harry, to track meets for over 35 years. And I know how the kids are. They love to see their parents at their event. There's no question. And I say that if we do something immediately to the kids, whoever it may be, because I've always told my kids that if somebody hits you, hit them back. You may get punished, but hit them back. So therefore, and I know that, because you may get punished, but you have gotten hurt. Not the teacher, not the principal, not the superintendent, but you. So I'm saying to you that you have to stop the fights immediately. And I don't care who's involved. Thank you,
Mr. Dixon. And let me address some of that. And those people in the room that know me, we had fights, but I didn't tolerate it. One of my favorite terms, and I use for disciplinary actions, and always put on the disciplinary card, actions detrimental to the continuance of the educational process. And you label that with a fine and send them home, that was it. Remember that, actions detrimental to the educational process. One fight, two fights, that affects the entire school. That affects the students, it affects the teachers. It affects the educational process. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Alfonso Nusson. In my humble opinion, we have to do something with the fights, but I believe that fighting is the final culmination of situations that have been set forth years ahead of time. This is just the final result of policies and procedures that has allowed this to fester. What I'm doing right now is echoing some of the words from teachers of Educators United for Coatesville. Those of you who have passed those papers out, they have chronicled the steady progression and demise and why we are here where we are today. See, you just can't look at the fight because you're getting ready to put a Band-Aid on some cancer. If the policies, procedures, if the removal of men of color from the district creates a void in the relational piece, then you got a problem. If you remove alternative ed, which may some people may like it or don't like it, if that creates a problem, that might be a piece you want to do as well. Total inclusion without proper support is a problem in the classroom. You have somebody with a disturbance issue. You got somebody that's slow at learning mixed with people that can learn real well. You got a problem, and you got gasoline, and you're just throwing in matches. That's why you see fights in the hall. Maybe somebody's not abreast with the lesson of that day. So he's sitting there drumming his fingers, becoming a distraction. We need proper support. And this is something else we forget. On this paper, I have 500 kids that made comments about the district. One of the persons is the class president of 2016 who feels that their senior year has been robbed from them. Nobody reads these words from the kids that we claim to be serving. We as adults, we come up with our own ideas. We totally ignore them. I gave this to everybody in the audience at the school board meeting and the school board members. Don't know if anybody read it, but you should be talking to them at some point in time in your life. I think we're doing them a disservice, and because you don't like me, you won't get into the message. Forget the messenger. I talk to teachers all day, every day. They're afraid to come out and tell you what's going on. Their hands are handcuffed. They know if they get too involved in fights and action like that, they could be reprimanded. All kinds of problems can happen. And I don't believe they're lying. So that's all I got.
Well, thank you. Whoa. Let me address that. And I understand. I hear this. But let me tell you something, ladies and gentlemen. We have a school board. I don't care. Everybody in this room, we can sign 100 petitions, we could do this and do that, but we have to communicate these issues and concerns to the school board, which we will follow up in the next couple weeks after we meet with them. Let me tell you, there are a lot of resources. We forget one thing, economics. When we cut teachers and we cut salaries and we cut programs, you know, it's so the school district can survive. And a lot of times there are shortcomings. This happens all the time. Look at Chester, Pennsylvania. How'd you like to be a teacher in there? Some of us wouldn't survive in some school districts. You can't mention or name
one of the old-time schools like Germantown out of Philadelphia, Overbrook. Why do you think they closed down? We don't want that to happen in our area. That's why I re-emphasize that we work with our school administrators and sit down. They're willing. It's basically new people in this area, but we have to sit down and explain these and come up with some solutions. Like Mr. Dixon, I'm old school too. But you address the problem, you address the bullying, and you address the parents. Whoa. Ladies and gentlemen, we're not going to have any of that. Okay? See ya. Bye. Ladies and gentlemen, we didn't come here for this. We did not come here for this. Members of the school board that's here, they know. The citizens know. This will be addressed. I don't want to hear from people that, have an axe to grind. Our axe tonight are our children. We have to come up with a problem to save them. The past is the past. We got to move forward. Amber?
Representative Lewis, I'm going to move over to the left side because we have two comments over here. So
I'm glad you're controlling that.
If you could stand up, sir. And actually, I'm going to hold the mic from now on. Can you all hear me in the back? Awesome. So if you could just speak loud and clear, that would be amazing. And if you could state your name, please. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Tom Audette. I'm here this evening because my son, Joseph, was just recently picked to participate in the leadership summit for all the school districts in the county. After that, Channel 6 News did an interview with him. He spoke up. The next day, a $40 bounty was put on his head to have him beat up. One of the students that was on that list was beat up. Now, fortunately, that day, my son was home because he had an issue. And I got a phone call from the school police officer informing me of this. I said, I want charges pressed. He's looking into it. I met with Dr. Tashner, and I told her, my son will not step foot back in that school, ever. I have another son that graduates this year. My daughter graduated 3 years ago. My son's going to be the first one in my family not to graduate from Coatesville because he will not go back. Now, here you have a student that is working on his Eagle Scout, participated in the leadership summit, has been suspended for skipping class. He's not an angel. Anybody in here who knows me knows that when I get a phone call from a teacher, I say, what did my son do? Not my son. Because that's what I call this generation, the not my son or daughter generation. I'm tired of hearing that teachers are afraid of parents, that the parents don't step up. I work with a lot of organizations. I've started clubs. I help a lot of kids. And you know what the sickening thing is? Parents don't care. You want to fix it? Find the parents. Student gets in a fight? Give the parent the fine. Student gets in a fight? Put the parent in jail. You want to fix it? Go after the parents, because these people in this city do not care. How many people are in this district and how many people are in this room? Sickening. Go to a school board meeting. How many people are there? Nobody. Sickening. People don't care. You want to address the elephant in the room? Get the parents, go after them. Get the parents involved. And the only way to do it is start finding the parents and start going after the parents. Now, if you'd like to ask my son any questions, he'll gladly tell you how many fights he sees. He'll gladly tell you what the repercussions for everything are. But it doesn't matter. What matters is get the parents involved. Stop having the teachers being afraid of the parents. And another thing to the school district, stop saying police officers, it's police officer. Let the police in the damn school. Why is it that police are not allowed in the school unless called by a principal? You put useless security officers in there. No, you need police officers in there. This school to prison pipeline, bullcrap. I worked in a prison for a lot of years. I was one of the troublemakers. Mr. Lewis can tell you that. There's a lot of teachers in this room who can tell you that. You know what the difference between me and those inmates was? I grew up, they got caught. That's the only difference. These people don't grow up, and they're the ones that don't care. They're the ones having kids. They're the ones who aren't teaching their kids. I'm done. In 3 years when my son graduates, I'm selling my home, I'm out of here. Because it's gotten sickening. And until you start addressing the elephant in the room, you're not fixing it. Good luck.
Thank you.
I want my son, he's going to private school, and I'm going after the district to pay for it. I shouldn't have to pay for my son to go to a different school because he's not safe in the district he's in. You can't guarantee my son's safety anymore. He's out of there. And I have to say, my other son, thank you to the teachers that helped him, because they did an amazing job. And the ones that are there, Dr. Roberts, Mr. K, amazing teachers. And we have some great teachers in our district, but at the same time, call it what it is, we have some horrible teachers in our district too.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Audette. And ladies and gentlemen, you know, as I said, we want to hear what everybody has to say, and your son, you know, applaud him for being here, but I don't want him to have to talk. I know he's just like his dad, and I remember those days. But we really, and that's a testimony to what we're working with. And we have people here that are listening. When I go back, and, you know, Dr. Tasher's here, you've seen her come in here, we will, I guarantee you, we're going to work this out so we don't have that. We can't afford to lose our kids to other schools. We just can't. We don't want our strong community people to leave because of this. That's why this is important, that we come together, the school district, the city, the citizens of Coatesville. We have to find a way. And once you're called on to volunteer and to help, we don't want to hear any excuses. The school board is in control. They understand. We will work with them. We will help them. And you're absolutely right. Make the parents accountable. That's the bottom line, ladies and gentlemen. These are kids. These are not adults. Let's all be accountable. We got to go back, and I'm going to go back to this bullying thing. We got to start there. And when we say no tolerance, we got to have no tolerance, and we have to enforce it. If it's your kid, suffer the consequences. These kids are identified. We have cameras. We have proof. You know, you have to, you know, separate the wheat from the chaff at times. Who else? Amber?
Hi, Mr. Lewis. My name is Karen Chominski. Two things. I heard at one of the school board meetings that one of the teachers suggested to get the cell phone out of the classroom. It doesn't need to be there. We all went to school. Unless it's part of the educational process for that day, why does a cell phone have to be in the classroom? And two, I read an article by Loretta Lynch, who is the Attorney General for the United States. She has proposed a law on limiting how discipline is handled in the school districts. Can you tell me if there are laws in the state of Pennsylvania that limits the ability of the administrators and the teachers to discipline kids?
As far as cell phones?
No, as far as any discipline.
That's up to the local districts and the school boards. That's what.
Are there rules that are in play that keep teachers and parents, or teachers and superintendents, from disciplining these kids? You were a teacher.
Yeah, I'd have probably, if they monitored me, Lord knows where I'd be. But no, that's the job of the local school boards, and that's what I'm talking about. We can help them with those rulings. That's a very difficult rule. I've been around so long, and I remember when we would suspend students for having cell phones. Okay. That was a phase we went through. You weren't allowed to even walk with your phone in the hallway. Let me get back to that. Because what had happened, remember the bomb scares and all of that? then the parents start raising Cain. I want my son, I want my daughter, especially the daughters, to have a cell phone. Remember the bomb scares? Exactly right. But what happens is, and technology is so advanced now, it's very, very difficult. You have cell phones and cameras everywhere. That's the way of life. But the school board can make a ruling. They can't control. It's going to be very difficult to control the cell phones. Well, you have the parents. It's a private issue. And they backed off of that a long time ago because just what you're talking about now, I want my daughter to have a cell phone because if something's dangerous happening at that school, I want to be the first one there. I don't want to wait for an email. I don't want to wait for someone to call me. I want my daughter to call me right now and let me know so I can get there. That's very difficult to control. Who's that? I'm sorry. Exactly right. But let me say this, and that's a very difficult issue. I can't think of any kid that's going to go to the teacher and say, I need to call my parent. And because that's just the times. They won't do that.
Representative Lewis?
Yes.
I can check on the law in regards to what she's asking about as far as discipline in the schools. But we'll have one of our staffers write that question down and then get back to you if that's okay.
And once again, it's up to the school board. I don't care what the law is. It's the school board.
Hi, Representative Lewis. My name is Rhett Lipscomb.
How are you?
Thank you. I'm doing well.
Seeing you, Rhett.
Mr. Lewis, you said you got the school $500,000.
Yeah, that's part of the, that was a part of the funding. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Why didn't you vote for Governor Wolf's budget? We would have received $8 million.
Yeah, you would have received $8 million, but you'd have to pay PIT taxes and taxes on your diapers, on soda, and this kind of stuff, plus an 11% tax increase. That's why I voted against that budget. But the budget I voted for is passed. That's why you got the $500,000. Okay. And thank you, Red, for that. But let's stay on topic here.
I'm back on topic. I'm Amelia Mills, taught at Rainbow, central office for years, worked with Harry and many of the people in the back of the room. I taught Audette's children in elementary school, brilliant, all of them. I'm following what Fawn says, it starts early. And I would like to speak a little bit about elementary school also should be included in what you're looking at. In my community in Westcown, I now help out by going to the school and picking up kids who are too afraid to ride the bus home. So I'm an approved driver now for the couple kids in my neighborhood. So the problems start in the elementary school and the safety issues are there. And you asked about, there is a discipline code. The school district has one and the superintendent wrote in her letter that she's tweaking it for next year. I'm kind of curious about what those tweaks are, and are the tweaks going to be more rigid or something else? The one thing in particular that I did when I did work in central office is my job was to report on data to the state, and some of the data was on the fights and stuff like that that happened, whatever they say, whatever that safe school report was. And the state has very firm definitions, at least they did when I did this several years ago, on what is a fight and what is an attack. So in an elementary school, when a child is walking and unprovoked and is bopped on the back of the head, is that an attack? And what is the school policy for handling a young person that attacked another kid? In my neighborhood, I love my neighbors. They're very young. They have wonderful young children. All they talk about now is putting their houses on the market. I jokingly said I wanted to interview anybody before they bought their home, but I'm heartbroken because they don't feel the kids are safe in the elementary school, and they're worried. A little bit on history. Now, when I taught, when Harry taught, and a bunch of others around here, there were always fights. I broke up fights, and I'm not that big. But we took care of it. We had a plan. The kids were disciplined. They knew they couldn't do it. We did what we had to do, and we managed it. So I'm curious about what caused it to become unmanageable. When did we stop managing the kids? I know they love the teachers. I know they love the administrators. Something went awry. And I love you for your comment, but it isn't cell phones. Cell phones are now part of the generation for safety. So kids have their cell phones for safety, and sometimes they catch people doing things they shouldn't be doing. So let me see if I got my notes. All right. So my people in my neighborhood who are very involved parents on the PTO are now quitting the PTO. They're frustrated because they don't consider the communications with the school board an adequate policy. I know some of the school board members have wonderful hearts, but somehow or another those meetings became very controlled. So Harry, anything you can do for a forum in addition to outside to collect would be a good thing, where everybody's voices could be heard without concern. And I thank you.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Good evening, everybody. I'm William Miller. I've worked with Representative Lewis. I'm also a master's level educator, and I'm a professor at Lincoln University, and I'm also a school teacher in Chester County at another school district. One thing that I noticed has not been mentioned in this room, and it's the root of a lot of these fights in the school, social media. 70% of school altercations start before school on social media. If social media is not allowed in the school, that will decrease a lot of the altercations. A lot of these fights start on the internet. The difference between now and 15 years ago, and years ago, the years you were referencing, the bullying does not go away. The second it's put out there on social media, a kid in China is reading about it. It cannot be deleted. Nothing that's put into cyberspace can be deleted. If you can control social media in the school, just in the school alone, there will be a huge reduction in altercations in the school. That's just in school. You can't control it at home. But a lot of these kids, they notice altercations are going to happen before they walk through that door. And the kid in Callan does not live near the kid in West Callan. So they only see each other at school. And now the teachers and the administrators have to deal with that social media battle that turned into a physical fight. So I've talked to Representative Lewis, as I work with Representative Lewis. I've seen him address it with different administrators in other school districts. I've seen him address the lack of diversity in the schools bluntly with other administrators. So I'm here speaking to you from the heart. I was born and raised in Coatesville. Fortunately and unfortunately, I landed a job in another local school district. If we can monitor our kids' social media, we can reduce a lot of this violence. If we can get them to understand, once it's put out there, you can't erase it. Someone somewhere has it saved. Or a screensaver, a snapshot. That's all I need to say, and I hope everybody considers that going home when you see your children, teenagers, on the internet. They know the fight's going to happen tomorrow or 3 days from now. Before you can even consider stopping it, you can go to them and stop it way ahead of time. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Megan Williams. I just wanted to say I'm here too because of the address the safety of the teachers as well as the students. I know firsthand there was an altercation in January where a student was beating another student. Teachers broke up that fight. Both teachers were injured. That student was not expelled from the school. The girl that she injured was out for 2 months and with concussions. That student withdrew herself. Her parents withdrew her from the district. She was suspended for 3 days. I believe that has since been changed to 10 days, but she had already left the district. Another teacher, just a few weeks ago, 9 months pregnant, a student got in her face and told her he would kick her until her baby came out. That student is still in the building and in her classroom. Another student has been physically assaulted by a student in her classroom 3 times. That student remains in the building and in her classroom. I am afraid for the safety of the teachers and the students as well. How do we fix that? Not sure. Right. I know it would be great if the parents would discipline, but a lot of the people who are here are the parents who are disciplining. These are the parents who are concerned. I would love to get to the parents, but they're not the ones who are here. That is a hard, hard problem to fix. The other question, Representative Lewis, when you speak with the superintendent and the school board to try to fix things, it would be nice if you'd also go to the teachers in the classrooms, the students in the schools. You were a teacher, that's great. But sometimes the policies we come up with in an office seem like a great idea, but those who are working with the students and deal with them every day may have some really, really excellent input on strategies that will actually work. There are students right now who are just walking out of the building in front of principals and assistant principals. And when teachers are asking, are we going to do anything about that, they just say, let them go. This is a huge problem, and I am very, very concerned. We have a 5-month-old daughter. We moved here thinking we would raise our family in Coatesville and are currently thinking the same thing. They have 4 years till we have to, you know, think about our daughter in school, 4 or 5 years. We are currently thinking about moving, and we were planning on staying here. You lose taxpayers. You don't have students in the school district. You are losing jobs. You are losing taxpayers. That loses the money that goes to all of our students. And in our development, about 2/3 of the children who live there now go to private school, charter school, don't go to their home district. Why? And who is out asking those parents why they don't send their kids to Coatesville? Thank you.
Thank you very much. And this is another reason I wanted this meeting, and my schedule really only allowed this day. But what you're talking about now, these are the kinds of things that we want to talk with our school board and talk with our administrators and our superintendent. We got a month and a half, and when we come back, we want to address and see what's in the discipline code. And am I correct? We got administrators here. Does every parent receive a copy of the discipline code at the beginning of the year? And is it still updated? And I guess that's what the superintendent's going to do now, because I know at least it's supposed to be updated at least once a year. Anyway, okay, that was just my own personal question. Go ahead, I'm sorry.
Hi, my name is Brianna Carr. I have a student that just recently graduated Coatesville High School. I have one that will be graduating next year, and I have one in elementary school. I'm not normally one for speaking up, but at this point, for the safety of my kids and my youngest especially, I feel as though something needs to be done. I'm one of those parents, I email my child's teacher. I can't get to the school due to work, but I'm involved. I talk to my students, they're very well behaved. When I get emails and notifications from the school district and from the school, I expect those things to be accurate. I take those emails and memos that we get as face value. They say, don't believe social media, don't believe this, don't believe that. So when I get those emails and I'm seeing these things at work, I'm thinking it's okay until I come home and my child has scratch marks all down his face and on his chest. This was not part of the memo that went out that same day. This is not something that was addressed that day. As a parent, I had no knowledge of the altercation. When following up with the school district, I had to constantly stay on them to find out what happened. For me, as a parent who is involved, who cares, My child is a good child. Why did this happen? It happened. Why wasn't I notified? Is it because a teacher who broke it up was scared to report it? Is it because they're worried about numbers versus the safety of your kids? I should have been notified. Had my child not come to me and said, hey, mom, look at this, how would I have known? I don't understand where the break is. The teachers are scared to say something, that the school district is worried about the numbers that they're reporting to the state. But as a parent who does everything that I can do, why isn't my child safe in school? And if there's an issue, why am I not notified? And you're saying, don't believe, don't believe, don't believe. These kids, he's in school every day and sees it. My kids see it. Why aren't we supposed to believe what we're hearing, and we're supposed to take face value what the school district is telling us is correct? Where is the disconnect? And the same thing is happening at elementary school levels. It's not just high school. So when these elementary kids are coming through, they're coming through the ranks. So 2 years ago, this escalated. So now those ninth graders, where it started to escalate, are going to go into the senior building. What is the superintendent's solution to it? Oh, we're just going to make it so that they don't go to each building. What's that going to do? They're now, the ninth graders that when it started to escalate are now in the senior building. What are you doing but just segregating them? The problem needs to be fixed. Teachers need to have some support from not only the community, but as they're from their employers, and parents need to be told exactly what's going on.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Joyelle Venezia. I'm a parent. I'm a graduated student of Coatesville. My father was a police officer. My mother did social work for the area. And I have children that have graduated. I have one in the high school building, one at elementary school level, and one that has not started yet. I'm from here. We're family. We're community. And nobody wants to have to leave from their roots. The thing that I see over and over again is, because I'm a collector of opinions and ideals and outlooks, what I see when I come into this setting, or what I see when I go to the school and talk to teachers and staff and other parents and outsiders that I hear about Coatesville from, what I see is that we need to take a look at ourselves, not just to look at ourselves, but look inside of ourselves. We all have an opinion, we all have an offense, and we all have our own idea, but we have to separate this divide, the divide from school board down to teachers, to parents, to students and staff. We have to stop pointing our fingers and look at ourselves and really separate what is inside ourselves that we're teaching our kids. The fights are happening because there's a lack of self-esteem. There's a lack of positive mental attitude. There is a lack of our own accountabilities. When we have these conversations and these kids are present, they're taking on our attitudes, and they're taking them to other students who don't even have the mental maturity to try to work it out. So they can't verbalize that they're afraid. And the only way they know how to react is by putting their hands on each other. And there's nobody saying that that is not a structural result for anything. But it's not. We're being judged. We're being judged from Downingtown and Westchester. Parents who've moved here from California, and they talk about their reading numbers and math numbers and go on the internet and look at ours. And we have to find out how we're going to create an atmosphere where people who don't have a college education can speak to someone that's staff that has a college education, and create an atmosphere where we trust each other again. Community is based off of being able to communicate, but communication is a two-way thing, and we have to set up an atmosphere where we can all speak to one another respectfully, and then gain trust in one another, that the information I'm giving you, you're not taking away with your own attitude about where I came from, what level of education, whatever happened yesterday. But what we're going to do moving forward, and what we all have to do, is start to come out and forget about yesterday and look forward to how we're going to reunite Coatesville as a family. We have to start to believe in each other again. We have to stop looking down our nose at ignorance for one another. I have felt, because I've come from living on subsidy to being able to pay my own way, I have felt that I can't have conversations with people with doctorates or high up educated, you know, staff members and just other people in the community, because you get a sense of, oh, you're just talking today and you won't be there tomorrow. And then when you come back tomorrow, sometimes there's a sense of, oh, she just has the time for today. Let's just put her on hold and get back to her later. And you feel like you're not being taken seriously. And it happens from both ends. My husband always tells me, if you're not a part of a solution, you're part of the problem. This didn't begin overnight, and it's not going to end overnight. But we have to start to be fair, and we have to start to trust one another and give that trust in return. Because if we don't do that, like these parents and the teachers and staff, we're going to lose our city. We're going to all, any of us who bring value financially or education-wise, they're leaving. And others are coming in. And Coatesville won't be Coatesville. There was a Coatesville over 20 years ago where people were excited about being on student council. And people weren't afraid to say, I'm quote unquote a nerd, because we knew that there was future in wanting to read a book and wanting to be educated. We have to stop being so athletic mind and prone, because there are others of us who are not athletic, and we still have to feel like we're part of the system. And the kids, they're very intimidated. A lot of people are functioning under a mind state of intimidation. And we have to somehow figure out how we're not going to allow each other to feel intimidated. You have to kind of open up and be human, because we're all humans. We all make mistakes. None of us are perfect. And education doesn't put you at a higher level of anything than anyone else. But there is something that is more expensive than we worried about getting these budgets passed. And ignorance costs so much more than having an education. And we have to set up a common ground where we can respectfully and decently place out our concerns and know that we're going to get a return. And that's what I'm seeing. So I've never come to a school board meeting, but I've had plenty of one-on-one with staff. And today, when I came in here and just listening, we have to stop being divided. There's a divide. And this community won't survive on being divided. We need to come up with a vision that feeds our future. There was reports, and they're saying at the school that it's a war zone. It's sad, because my 15-year-old comes home, and I see light in his eye. Oh, they said it's a war zone. What we need to do is teach our children the difference between fights and wars. Fights don't get us anywhere. War has a strategy. War knows who the enemy is, and war comes with a plan. And we have to identify that school board, staff, and students, and parents, we're not each other's enemies. Our future is at risk. These kids are not learning. They're afraid, and they can't learn. And until we create a solid, self-esteem-based mentality for these kids, it's going to keep going this way.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. Very, very well said, and the crux of this meeting. Amber, I'm sorry.
That's okay.
Go ahead.
Linda Messenger, I live in Callan Township. Some of you might recognize me. I was on the school board many years ago. I remember Harry. I don't know if he remembers me. I wish you luck, Harry, talking to the board and the superintendent. I'm glad that the members are here, administrators, teachers, school board members, Dr. Tashner. I hope you listen to the people that are here tonight that you have not seen at the board meetings. There's usually about six of us that show up. And now we've been labeled as troublemakers, F-nuts, misfits, whatever, because we've tried to get our opinions out there. And frankly, this school board and some administrators have totally tuned us out. I hope that what you're hearing from the parents that are concerned about their children's safety makes you think twice, that maybe we're not Como supporters. Maybe we're not misfits. Maybe we're not looking for the evil in everyone. We want to see things change. We want to see things become more positive. But this school board has to start listening to the community. And this school board needs to start realizing they are in control. The superintendent, whoever that may be, is not in charge of the school board. It's the other way around. And school board members, start listening to your parents. If Harry can make a change that the rest of us can't, power to him.
Good afternoon, everyone. Can everybody hear me in the back? Okay. I just wanted to make sure I was back there. It was a little hard to hear. But I'm just here tonight not to say a whole lot. I'm just won't hold the mic for long, so please bear with me. But I'm just here not to say anything negative. Oh, I'm sorry. My name is Jared Elsers, by the way. I'm a sophomore at the high school.
Jared is also the president of the Coatesville Youth Philanthropy Group. And last week they just gave over $15,000 to various groups in the Coatesville area. And these are all youth. These are all our young people. They decided, they shifted through the grants, and they made the awards. So continue, Jared, because I'm very proud of you, son.
Thank you. The one thing I just wanted to say is please listen to us kids. I know we're talking about the problems that we're having with our children including myself. I think what we need to do is we need to start to bring our students into these conversations. When I look around the room, honestly, I'm probably the only person in here besides a couple friends that's under 18. And I'd like to see that change, and I'd like to see more people like myself represented in this type of environment, if that makes sense. I feel that the youth, our voice needs to be heard, and if I'm the only person that is going to be heard from the youth, then so be it. But if I need to come to every meeting from now on to make sure that the problems that the children are seeing, the problems that the students are seeing are being heard, then I would do so. I feel that we need to open up opportunities for people like myself to be able to do so, and also for us to be able to voice our opinions on things of this sort. I'm not saying that that's not provided, but we can do a lot more to provide that for us as students, and I'm willing to work with anyone, really, to make sure that that can happen in our community, because I see a lack of unity between three groups of people, the students, including myself, the parents, and the school administration and teachers. It hasn't been gelling together, and I believe this is part of the problem that we're having lately. There's not well communication between either of the three groups, and for us to make it better, we need to bring all three groups together. Right now, we're only bringing two together and leaving the other one out and calling it a problem. So I believe the best thing for us to do right now is to come together as a group, including the students, being myself and my peers, to be able to help create solutions to the problems that we have. Thank you.
That's one of our future leaders. And Jared, you're just a 10th grader, 11th grade? Okay. That's the kind of product we have. And before we get to the next person, I want to ask, do we have any student members on the school board? Okay.
I was just elected junior class school board representative, so I'll be in that position.
Very good.
Hi, my name is Joey Audet, and I'm a freshman student. I'm a freshman student at Coatesville. Well, at least I was. As a former freshman or as a former student of Coatesville, I mean, I still go to Coatesville and the Turning Point thing, which is a great program, by the way. But I believe that my social life was taken from me by not being able to go to the main campus high school, and that they kind of sent me to the Turning Point program just to kind of get rid of me, and I feel that I was a side problem, and like they don't really like, I feel like that they just kind of got rid of me just to take care of the problem right away, and I feel like that was wrong because I loved my teachers and like the environment that I was in. The environment that I was in was a great environment, and the school is a great school. And the teachers are great teachers, and I don't think it's their job to stop fights. It was the policeman's job, and it's sickening that they got rid of the police. And to touch on like the phone situation, I believe that like the phones are they're a great resource, but they're not monitored in the right way. There's not enough rules, and there's not enough like I don't know. There's not enough rules on the phones, because the phones are the reasons why the fights happen. Because there's a kid that's in the other building that wants to fight somebody in the other, and there's a kid that's in the 11-12 building that wants to fight someone in the 9-10 building, and they can. Like, they can text, and they can say, meet me outside, or meet me in the lunchroom, and they can meet up, and they can fight, and without anybody knowing, because they talk from two buildings away. So I believe that the phones are, they just need to be monitored better. But to get back on the subject of me getting taken out of the main high school, I think that was wrong, and I don't know. It's just horrible that the way it is, and I feel like the environment that we're in is—it's a bad environment. And kids might think it's a joke that they called us a war zone, that they called the high school war zone. That's disgusting. That's horrible. It shouldn't ever—a school should never be compared to a war zone. If there is something majorly wrong with that, and I think that some of my friends they think it's a joke, but to me I take it seriously as a person that. Had like got bullied out of the school. This is my life now. Like, I have to deal with that, and now my social life was robbing me from that, all because I wanted to speak up. And kids thought I made Coatesville look bad by saying that there was fights, when there are plenty of fights to go around in the school. And I don't think if my parents asked me, they would ask me like, was there a fight today in school? And I'd be like, yeah, there was a really big fight. They wouldn't get a call. They would get a call saying everything was fine. That the people lie. I just think it's horrible, and the way that they deal with things in the schools is, I think, childish. By hiding the facts, they need to let the facts out. Ignoring problems does not make problems better, it just makes them worse, and it makes the kids feel like they have no, there's no repercussions to any actions.
Thank you for your perception as a student. And we really don't want to lose you, and I hope we can work towards in convincing you and your parents to come back to Coatesville after we have these seminars and work with our school district and administrators. We don't want to lose the kind of quality you bring to our district. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, my name is Jill Santiago, and I have a whole list here because I have to stay on task or I'll be off task. I'm a very solution-oriented person, so you know, there are a lot of concerns and there are a lot of issues within the community, and sometimes I feel like I sit somewhere in the middle because I really do believe in restorative practices. I really do believe in inclusion, maybe not total inclusion, but as a parent of several kids with special education needs, I really believe that those kids, if it's at all possible, should be included within the district as far as the classroom. However, being a solution-oriented person, I think my distress is not seeing a plan for kids being put back into classrooms with a lack of supports and services. So to me, one of the solutions is there really needs to be a better plan for supports and services back into the district, which would decrease some of the issues that you're seeing within the schools. I don't believe in zero tolerance. I believe there's a way to discipline kids, if that's the word that you want to use, without there being zero tolerance. But it takes a plan. It's a planful process. I am a firm believer in community and family engagement, but again, I believe it takes a plan. There needs to be a plan for everybody to come together and to enrich the schools with community and family engagement. I believe in school mental health services. I would love to see a solution there built around school-based mental health. I don't think people feel welcome anymore. I know I certainly don't feel welcome anymore. And many of these administrators here have worked with me for years. They know me, they know my kids. I think parents need to be allowed back at the table to come up with these solutions. And it may not mean it's a parent who believes in the plan or who is 100% invested in whatever the philosophy of the school district is. We need to be allowed back at the table. I believe in youth and family voice. There should be youth at the table. There should be family at the table. Those of us who have both professionally and have lived experience within special education, mental health, we need to be allowed back at the table in order to come up with solutions. I believe the community has been taken out of the district. The community needs to be back in the district. I think that is one solution. Trying to stick here. And I think that's pretty much it.
Thank you.
All that. Him and I don't usually, we usually butt heads, but I got to agree with him this time. I'm Jim Fox. I used to be on the school board. Yep. I used to be on the school board. I ended up resigning about 2 years ago. Wasn't because of what was going on there. It was because of other things. But I enjoyed it. But when I was on the school board, we had what was called a discipline committee, made up of myself, other board members. Myself, other board members. I believe you remember Judge Johnson before he passed away. He was a lot harder than we were. But there were circumstances and discipline that was dealt out equally, fairly. And we had a lot of this under control. We had our fights, but it was taken care of. The children were brought in front of us. We made a decision on each child separately. They were checked out separately, and their discipline was given out separately. What we got was bombarded from the community because they said we had too many suspensions. Too many suspensions. So I saw what was coming in. I saw what was being taken care of, so I resigned. That's why I resigned, okay? But I agree, discipline has to come back in. The teachers have to control their classrooms. They cannot be afraid to send a child that's being disruptive to the principal's office, and the principal has to take care of it from there. That child has to be, because we could have 500 police officers in the schools, but if that child knows there's no repercussions, there's nothing you're going to do. He knows nothing's going to happen to him. So it's time we step up and we bring this discipline back into our schools and get back to teaching our children.
Hello, everyone. I'm his wife. I'm Valerie Fox. Our daughter is going to be a senior this coming year. And quite frankly, she was very afraid. She was very afraid these last few months in school because of all the altercations, disruptions. And I have to say, if my child is afraid to go to school and has to turn around in her car to come back home because there are fights outside the school and she's missing time, we have a definite problem. Because they're not learning, they're starting to collect in groups, and it's deceiving to our children, whether you're white, black, yellow, purple, whatever you are. I'm sorry, we're not racist. I grew up in this town. I lived on First Avenue. I still have friends who live in First Avenue. We're not racist. There may be some, but you know what? This community came together. When I was a student in this wonderful city called Coatesville, my sister's a teacher. My God, she has kids, grown-ups, adults, who come back to her and say, Miss Petro, oh my gosh, I remember when you were my teacher, and I am so proud. I am a proud graduate of Coatesville, the Red Raiders. And all I hear now is fights, fights. And it's going to blow up in our faces, folks. We have to come together as parents, as students, and I congratulate this young man, Jared. We have students like this, but you know what? We're not fixing the problem coming up in the grades. We're not paying attention to our students, to our children who become young adults, who become Mr. Harry Lewis, a state representative. We ought to all be ashamed of ourselves. If we can't pay more attention to our students and our children, let me tell you what, folks. Coatesville's going down very quickly. My husband and I were getting on in years. Hopefully him better than me, but we're trying to sell our home to stay in the area. But when you tell someone you live in the Coatesville Area School District, they look away. They don't want to look at your property. Now, isn't that a shame? Because of where you live? I don't hear any of this being talked about in Lionville. I don't hear about it in Downingtown. I don't hear about it at Pope John Paul. Do they make a point of disciplining very quickly? Or do they drag it out? Or do they put it under the rug? We have great teachers, and some we don't. So let's start weeding out. Let's get a plan. And you know the song, "What Doesn't Kill You Makes You Stronger"? Let's hope we don't get to the first part before we get to the second part. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Deborah Thompson. I will not be go and miss not speaking. I hear you. I've heard you. I'm just going to say this to you honestly. I do believe that police have its place in the grounds. But I think had people come to some of our meetings and some of our forums that we had on safety and police versus security on a Saturday to make it convenient to hear your voice. We pulled together judges, we had the NAACP, the ACLU, there to talk about what that means to children. It doesn't mean that discipline goes away. It is the expectation that discipline is going on. Now, but do we want our children to receive citations that may follow those students as they grow into an adult that make different decisions? And I can speak to myself and my brother. Many of us grew up here in this community and remember when kids of a certain size or kids that fought, considered troublemakers, were put in special ed. My brother, who had was diagnosed with ADHD way back then, and I'm 57, was put in ninth grade in special ed. And it was a teacher that came there that pulled my brother out and said, "You sit in this class and do what this teacher tells you because you don't belong here." My brother graduated with honors. He is civil engineer and went to the business school of Wharton and has had a very prestigious career. I was in all kinds of fights. Why? And I hated ninth grade at Scott. Hated it. Why? Because I was in a fight almost every day, and I stopped going to the point that I missed so many days that I should have failed. But because I was intelligent, and when I did go, I could pass my test. Most of the fights I didn't start. But I tell you what, I beat a teacher so bad that sat on me, not proud of it, that they took me to the school board. The school board at that time looked at my grades, not my attendance, asked me why did I stop coming. I said, because I'm tired of fighting. I don't want to fight every day. Every day I go here, it's a fight. They put me in cash. I went to cash for 3 years. Had we had police back then, I guarantee you, I would have had many citations, and I would not be a registered nurse today because I had citations on my record. These citations will block kids from certain jobs. So I say as a community, we have to come together and determine what our children, what the value of our children means to me and means to you. When I see kids cussing, and some households, that's the word. They just cuss. It's just English to them. So when they come to school, they just use that same language. It's not right in any setting to me. I see kids, and it's how you talk to them. I say, please don't use that language. Young ladies don't talk like that. Young men, stop talking like that. And guess what? They don't cuss me out. They may go around the corner and still do what they do, but I get a positive response. I think it's all how we respond to them. I say we have to be willing to save our children, each and every one of them, because some of these kids are ornery and bad or in a state of trauma. Because I tell you what, people didn't know, and some of these people in here may very well know that, and I can speak about myself, and I'm not ashamed of it. I'm not ashamed to speak on it, let me put it like that. That as a child, I was molested by multiple babysitters, male and female. I had men and guys in this town, even as a teenager, turn me every which way but loose. People didn't understand why I was so angry and a loner and didn't trust the girls that was with me because they always wanted to fight me because so-and-so was liking me that I wasn't even liking. But see, you don't know the pain that might very well be in some of these children that are intelligent. But guess what? If they leave this district, if you throw them in some kind of alternative program that isn't valued or considered like they considered it back in the day, if you had it on your resume, you were in special ed, and your curriculum didn't gear you towards college, these kids are going to be destined to be lost. And guess what? I don't like paying taxes to keep people in jail that got cable TV and all of that. People are going to feed themselves. And we will set children up for failure. These are kids. And I say to us, we have to do something to offer parents and children the help that they need in this community. Coatesville can turn around. We are only 13,000 people. We can save this community if we will come together and speak. Do we, in the times of today, do we maybe need police on our grounds? Yes, and I believe that, and people do not realize that the reason why they are requested to speak to the principal and to the superintendent so that they're not just giving a citation to the child, because if I punched you in the mouth, and you, somebody said, I started the fight, that's an assault. Or is it just students fighting that need help, that student causing the fight should get in trouble? That child, we have a phone policy. I asked the parent, have you read it? Did you read it? Parents aren't even reading our codes. This is the issue, and these are parents that are in the school. Did you read the policy? Are you enforcing the policy in your home? We can't do it all. And most of this stuff, as it has been said, begins in the street, begins in the home. Teachers cannot be your parent, but I tell you what, teachers can make a change in somebody's life. Because there's many a person that may have come out of a household. I have a nephew whose mother was a drug addict. You would have thought he would have been lost. We have a person right now that's graduating with an academic scholarship who you know him, and my girlfriend wouldn't be ashamed, nor his mother, for me to say it. And I'm talking about Rome. Against all odds, he graduated with honors, with an academic scholarship. That's huge to be celebrated. But hopefully, the elements of this community, we have had kids that graduated and had sports scholarships, but yet they go to college and they get into trouble. Why? And guess what? The good thing that came out of those videos that were shown was that it's not just black kids fighting. It's black and white kids fighting. I had a white child tell me that it's white males and black females. And the black females fight in groups. We can make a change. We have to speak up and deal with it. From the pulpit, even from the home, it starts in our churches and in our community. Speak up to our children. And most importantly, love covers a multitude of sins. We have to love on one another. There's not enough love. There's a lot of pointing fingers. And we will come together in mass numbers when it's trouble. But let us come together to bring healing and to bring solutions. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you for that, Ms. Thompson. But I have to address one thing. And the reason I am, and it concerns the police department in Coatesville. I was one of the originators to bring the police department to the Coatesville School District. Now let me say, when I was a disciplinarian, I loved those guys. And if they are written up with a citation, it does not go outside the school district. It really does not. That's where our police chiefs, from Callan Township, from Coatesville, they all work together to help our kids. They don't send them off. And when they graduate, those records are expunged. Well, I'm explaining to you what I have, because all of these questions that you're asking have been addressed. This is just not new. There was a lot of thought that went into that. I wanted to say that because I was one of the creators. I've been around, I guess I'm a part of a creator of a lot of things. But that was one thing that was emphasized, because the same concerns that you say were concerns then also.
That forum, we had a judge from Kennett. We had people from the ACLU talk about certain kinds of professions that students will try to go into right after high school. They have been seen by the judge. It is on their record, and it has blocked some from going to the military. It has blocked some even from taking the bar, and they've had to have it expunged. And that information can be, that judge's name can be given to you. But he did come and he did talk on that.
Well, you know, that happened then, and I've been gone a long time. But it didn't happen when I was there, because we looked out for the kids. And let me tell you, you know, the worst things, but we made sure that they did not get out of the system when they graduated. All of their records are expunged. And that campus is like a mini city. So a lot of things happen that we don't know. We're going to Mr. Bailey, an educator, Coatesville grad. Go ahead.
My name is Dr. William Bailey. I've been an educator for 36 years. I never maintained a full-time job in Coatesville, but I worked in Avengrove, I worked in Westchester, I worked at the Bo Tech School, I worked at CDC. And I want to make one thing perfectly clear for all of you. There's fights in every school. Coatesville gets the rap because it's the news. Other districts do what we claim we do here. They don't report it. You know, realtors in our community don't say Coatesville. They do other things. Southview, up on a hill, they let you know they're located near the R5. But what I know from experience, home, school, and community, I believe in that. My last assignment was at a middle school in Upper Darby, which they recruited me to because of the problems that you're talking about right now. I had 1,500 kids in a middle school. 70 different countries, 71 different dialects. 8 African countries that were at war with each other. So fighting there took on another complexity. Now, I believe in every teacher and the right to come to work and leave healthy. I believe that there's not an administrator in any school that doesn't put the time in and go home whipped, because I've done this for a real long time. Our problem here is the infrastructure. We got to revisit what is going on, and we have to communicate what the rules are. That's to the kids, to the administrators, to the teachers. And it has to be with clarity and certainty that these things are followed. The next thing that I will share with you is accountability. And how do you, as a student, how do you as a parent or a teacher, achieve that accountability? What are the procedures that are written for one to follow? The superintendent doesn't run the district. They guide the district. People who are responsible are the board members. How do you access them? What is the procedure to log your complaint? There's a lot of pain in this room, and I feel it. And it's a horrible thing to have your child come. But it's equally as horrible to have a teacher looking for a new job every day because they feel they're not being supported. It's equally as important for administrators to toe that line every day and not be able to give direct answers. So it's a structural problem that has to be addressed. And you gotta not reinvent it, but go back through it to make sure that all the stakeholders are in place and have one thing, the ability to communicate and an understanding of what is taking place and why it's taking place. There should be no door shut. You talk about transparency, let's make it transparent. Talk so that people can understand, not just because they're listening. A lot of people listen, but they don't understand. Don't talk at people, talk to them at a level that they walk away with a sense, hey, this is no game, son. You're out of school because. You have to be able to accurately document what is taking place, because the world has become this. Everybody gets sued. You know, I couldn't do my job. I was sued every other day. Never really happened, but that, you know, you get those threats. Everybody is concerned about their employability. And what does that mean? You know, where's the cheese? Does the cheese always move, or does the cheese finally come to a standstill where we as a community, school community, coastal community, do we understand? But the biggest question, have we all done what we need to do to make this a better place? Can't be finger pointing. It has to be collaboration. And until we achieve that, we're still going to be the people the Daily Local write up. Because that's what sells. Coatesville sells in a negative way. And I probably could go on, but again, I want to do it from a global perspective that is not one individual or individuals. The hardest thing for an administrator to do is talk to an irate parent and there's no level of understanding. So as a community, we have to support what's right. Not our own personal agendas, but what is right. If we're going to get this community back, it has to start today. And people that are, like I always used to say at the meetings, first day of school, the only people I get to back to school night is the people I don't need to see. Yeah. And the people we need to be talking to, are they here? You all know them. Doesn't happen. But we have to find a mechanism to get to those parents and make them aware of what we feel. That's what happens.
I can't have my friend Mr. Bailey make comments. There are a number of former administrators in this room and former school teachers. There's one right here who was my mentor in the Downingtown School District. I served as an administrator, a teacher, a district level administrator for 32 years in Downingtown and a couple other school districts. And I heard, again, a lot of pain. I hear a lot of pain in this room. But as we leave the room, you have to realize that we can't lock up and suspend our way out of the problem. Along with that, we have to figure some way, somehow, I don't have the exact solution, some way of connecting with the parents. I mean, the parents, you talked about back to school night, the parents that should have been there, of course, they're not there at all. And that's the challenge that a lot of the young people have. In many cases, the parents are young. We can't compare our district to another district. We need to stop doing that. And we have to realize that some of the things we did 10 years ago, I retired in 2009. And 2009 is a completely different day than 2016, with 2017 approaching. We need some solution or some way of connecting with these young people, either through mediation and also figuring out some way of connecting with the parents. These parents are people. I'm also a pastor in a local church, so maybe that's the pastor piece, but that should be really all of us, in compassion. And I agree we have to be solid with the rules. Suspension is part of the discipline, but again, being super redundant, we can't suspend our way out of the problem. We must figure some way, put some solutions in place. How can we connect with these young people? And also, how can we avoid some of the disasters that continue to occur on our streets? And I know, again, the conversation is about our school system, but we're talking about Coatesville, period, that we need to come together and figure out how to connect with the communities. And you've heard that over and over again. Thank you for your attention.
And ladies and gentlemen, the last two speakers are Coatesville High School graduates, Dr. Bailey and Dr. Smith. And, you know, that shows you what we're capable of producing in our school district.
Good evening. My name is Jared Jackson, Coatesville NAACP. I heard the NAACP being mentioned. And in addition to communication, we also have a perception issue that we need to address, which is what we're seeing in the newspapers. The forum in which Ms. Thompson was speaking about, that was attended by Dr. Joan Duvall Flynn, who is the president of the state NAACP. But her involvement there was through her Trauma-Informed in Education Committee. So I just want to be clear that the NAACP is involved in the Coatesville Area School District. On a local level, we meet with the superintendent monthly, and although we are not seeing the progress that we desire, we are still here for the long haul because we understand that it's a process. And we have yet to meet with the school board despite several requests. And we really don't know what the issue is with that. So let's be clear in dealing with school safety, which is an issue that we have, is the simple fact of getting access to the proper individuals to help be a part of the solution and not just being viewed as a part of the problem. And so I just want to be clear because I'm obligated, whenever the NAACP is mentioned, to speak on their behalf.
Thank you, Jared, and you mentioned part of the problem, collaboration and meetings, and that's why we're here tonight, to clarify and make those things crystal clear.
Good evening. My name is Bill Washington. I was on the school board for approximately 9 years. Of course, that's been a few years back now, you know. But let me tell you, and you may be surprised at this, there was a time that the 910 Center and the Coatesville Area High School did not have this problem. They did not have it. There wasn't the fights going on. And you know one of the reasons why is because the parents let the teachers do their job and the teachers depended on the parents to do their job. And in the home, the father backed the mother up and the mother backed the father up. And in the schools, the teachers back each other up. They had rules and regulations that would sit down at the beginning of the year, and quite a few people sat down and wrote these rules and regulations. It wasn't just one individual, or teachers, or parents, or whatever. There was a group of people that got together and wrote these rules and regulations. And one of the things they left out of it, we were not afraid to be politically incorrect. Nowadays, they're walking on glass because everybody wants to be politically correct. I don't want to say the wrong thing. I don't want to point the wrong finger. I don't want to do this. I don't want to do that. Do you know we had teachers in that school district? Let me tell you, and this is going to be hard to believe. And Harry, you know it. Elwood, you know it. We had a principal, you hear me, that boys could not wear earrings in their ears. They couldn't walk in school with their hat on backwards. They couldn't show their underwear. Girls had to have their skirts down. There was no disrespect for the teachers. I mean, that's when I was on the school board. You know, and the teachers did this because they had the sanction of the parents. The parents said, that's fine. If this is how we're going to instill in these children that this is Institute of Education and not a social picnic like sometimes, you know, we look at it today. There was no cell phones allowed, and everybody was fine with it. No cell phones, no disruptions. And everybody, including the parents, were fine with it. Nowadays, you walk into school, they got cell phones laying on their desks, every one of them blinking and blasting and beeping and dodging. And the kids that really want to learn, all of a sudden, they're disrupted. They're thrown off track. My granddaughter, great-granddaughter, goes there. And this lady wants to learn. She's there to absolutely learn. But hey, every once in a while, you know, the head turns around because there's a flash going on or a sound behind you or somebody texting somebody or whatever. What is all that about? You want to text somebody, text them after school. Put that phone in your locker. Don't use it during the school hours. We have to get back to that where we all come together as one unit and have each other's back. The teachers having each other's back, the parents having each other's back, and the teacher and parents get together and applaud each other. Thank you.
We're going to tone down after this speaker, and then I'm going to make a final statement in respect for everyone's time, but go ahead, Don.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Kim Watson, and I am a bus driver and a very proud bus driver. Yes, I am. And I'd like to recognize my supervisors that are in the house in this forum. Mr. Lewis, thank you so much for having this forum. I also worked at the Coatesville Area High School, and I need to say just about every principal, assistant principal, administrative in this room, I take my hat off to you. I really do. Mr. Fisher, I love you. I've seen, and someone had made mention, I think Mr. Harry, you did, or someone had mentioned it, when we come to work, we have a good night's sleep and we are ready to prepare ourselves for these children. When we go home, we are exhausted. I don't know about anyone else, but I take my work home with me. Now, as someone also had made mention, it starts elementary school. I drive the school bus for elementary all the way up to the high school. I had some little elementary kids get on that bus and call me everything but Miss Gibb. And I need to tell you that.
I don't even use the words some of those elementary kids, and I try my best not to curse, but under my breath, and someone said, if I knew I wasn't going to get fired, I would rather pull that bus over and give them a couple little whacks. But someone had also made mention, one of the things that we do is when a child gets on the bus, we greet them. We know when a child's having a bad day or a bad night. So if they act up, we do write-ups. We turn those write-ups in. Or we call our supervisor, and they'll call in and say, Mary's having a bad day. We already know that when she woke up. When we call the school and let you aware of how the children's behaving, we expect you, when that child arrives to that school, to pull Mary or Bobby or whoever in the office and say, listen, what's going on today? We heard that you're maybe having a difficult time. That's where it starts at. We know what kids are troubled. Put it to you that way. When we find a trouble, or you know what kid, because when I worked in the school, I heard the teacher say, oh my God, here he come, or here she come. If you know that child is like that, Mr. Lewis, you know I worked with you and I came to you several times and said, immediately we took that child, or they took that child, Mr. Fisher, in the office and sat down and said, listen, what's going on? Call the parent in. Parent knows that they got bad kids. They know how their children behave. They really do. I'm not putting everything on the parent. But I'm hearing a lot about our hands are tied as well. We can only do but so much. Only but so much. So Miss McGibney and a few others who helped my granddaughter who was troubled, she was going through a lot. That little girl, the angry, hurtful little girl, I called the school. Miss McGibney, Miss Miles, Mr. Miles, they pulled us in the office and her mother didn't even want to come to the meeting. But we sit down, they went out of their way to help me to get help for my granddaughter. These are the kind of people I applaud you because they do want to help our children. But we have the courage to stand up to some of these parents who know even the mentally challenged children or whatever. Some of these children, they let them get away with certain things simply because the law says that they can only do but so much. I understand that. But you know when your child is bad and acting out of line. So, you know, I applaud everybody for coming. Only thing I can say is there is hope here. There is hope. That's why we showed up. Thank you for giving us hope and for letting us know we are in this thing together. It's not my city, her city, Mr. Lewis's city. This is our city, our family, even the trouble kids. They still belong to us. So we just need to go in prayer and try to help our best and go out of our way to help those who need the help.
Thank you, Ms. Watson. And ladies and gentlemen, with that, we're going to conclude this. And this has been recorded. My staff, if you want to talk to us privately, see Mrs. Little, Amber, or talk to Will or Nick or any of my staff. We will follow through, ladies and gentlemen. We have the documented version. We will work with the school administrators. I think we have enough true, heartfelt information tonight to work with over the summer. We're going to start. And when we come back, I want to have the answers to your questions through a collaborative with the citizens, with the state house, with the school district, and anybody that wants to be involved. Our office will work with you. And, you know, it's going to take some time, and we'll talk with the administrators and work on some of these issues that you bring up tonight. And I guarantee we will come up with a solution. And I don't want to put any time on it, but we'll have to work this summer and in September. I will bring, we're going to have the Education Committee from the Pennsylvania State House of Representatives, of which I am a member. They want to come here. So we're going to bring those and make a plan to have them come in September, after we have the answers to some of our own issues and some of our own situations. And I want all of you to come back, volunteer, give your names to Ms. Little. We will work with you, and we'll get back to you periodically as to where we're going. Like I said, I want a solution. I don't want to have this to be a one-time thing. You had a chance to talk. We heard you. We have it recorded. We will review it. And believe me, we have the House state staff to review some of these and bring up some reasonable kind of requests for our school district, our administrators, our teachers. We want to help you. We don't want to lose you. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you. And I appreciate this opportunity.